thing that if you are good at something, do it for the payslip. If you are really good at something, do it for the invoice.
Hello everyone, welcome to the fifth episode of our podcast Pepper Spotlight, where we speak to some of the brightest and the most creative minds in the content space. My name is Pawan Rochwani and I'm the host of this podcast show. I think by now we have established that pretty well. If you're watching this on YouTube, you might see a new set of branding around me as a background guest. As we are moving towards the next few episodes, we are upgrading ourselves, and you know, we are trying out new things and bringing in some new interesting folks on the show. In fact, for this entire episode, we should have named this as Show Day, because we have Gabbar Singh today on our episode. But not to crack any lame puns, let's just move on and let me introduce you all to the founder of Ginger Monkey, Abhishek Astana, who's very popularly known as Gabbar Singh on Twitter. He had started on Twitter 10 years back and created three different accounts of Gabbar Singh, Basanti and Kalia, and probably he just stayed with the Gabbar Singh account over the period of years, and now he has like a million followers on Twitter and also runs Ginger Monkey, which is a completely unique and very creative advertising company and organization, and we'll get to know more about how they work and how he's building this organization with some of the most coolest brands that you see on the internet today, like Durex or AirAsia, and some other very, very cool organizations are their clients. Let's get into the conversation with Abhishek directly to know about what he does. Thank you so much, Abhishek, for giving us your time and joining for this conversation. I can call you Abhishek, right? Or do you want to be called as Gabbar only?
Absolutely. That's the brand I'm trying to build now.
The very first question that I want to ask you, Abhishek, is, you know, I as soon as I went to Ginger Monkey website, I read this, that good advertising builds sales and great advertising builds factories. Mm-hmm. What really is this philosophy, and how did you guys decide this, and what really does this mean?
Yeah, so actually this is a quote I read in a copywriting book when I started this firm, right? I'll give you a brief intro as to why I started doing this. Yeah, so throughout my life I have done wore multiple hats. I was a techie in Samsung R&D earlier, then I went for my MBA, and the reason for going into an MBA was when I joined Twitter, I always had this thing to write stuff, to create something, and basically creative writing. I had a blog as well, which was decently that time popular as well. So I came to Twitter, I looked at people, and there was a completely different world altogether. See, when I used to go to work, I used to have people around me who would code stuff, who would be interested in that kind of stuff. We used to write code Samsung phone handsets. And then on the weekends, they would go write a mock cat, and they come back on Monday and discuss. So that was like the regime, right? Everybody was there. That's like the assembly line for you. You come into basically the first 2 years you spend to earn money to pay your loan back for engineering. And then you go on to do your MBA and take a fresh loan as such. So that's been the kind of an assembly line that most of us go through. And then I went through the same thing, same churn, came out. And before doing an MBA, I always had this thing that fine, I need to I need to create something. I was fascinated by advertising as well, creating content, creating all kinds of stuff which people usually appreciate. And coding was, I was okay. I was good at it. I got like, back to back three promotions to become a lead engineer when I was quitting. So I was not that it was bad. I was bad at it. I wanted to like escape that rut. I enjoyed that, but then I felt like I could do better than this and but then the root shock came when I actually went for my MBA. I thought this could be the portal to creativity, but I wasn't for a root shock. When I came out, I was posted in Navi Mumbai, and then I went to rural Maharashtra as well. And then I realized this is something which is going to take a lot more years for me to actually do something worthwhile, which I wanted to do. And eventually moved to an FMCG company, and then then became a brand manager and got to work on one of the most creative brands called Durex. And there I led a team as well to create. So this was the time when actually what I was hoping for to do, I got that like 5-6 years down the line when I could create something. I was leading a team as well, though I was managing the P&L. That was the bread and butter, but this was something which I did on the sides as well. And it got a lot of traction and that creative validation you want. And then what happened was that that was the experience. I was like, no, this is good. This can be replicated. If I just pluck this out, this whole system out of me coming in and leading a team of copywriters and designers and start something that can serve many more brands and kind of replicate that success we saw with Durex. That's when I thought that this is the moment to come out. And coming back to the original question of the good advertising builds sales, I read, of course, when I came out, the first thing I did, because I was never in advertising before. This was my first stint in advertising. And it is quite different, by the way. You feel like when you're a client, you are sitting at a different vantage point. So then I started reading copywriting books. And one of the quotes that was there, I forgot the name of the book. I guess it was from Whitman or someone, some foreign author book. This was there. Then I really like this quote. This is my philosophy, right? I don't want to be in advertising to just gain shares and likes. I want to be in advertising to help businesses. And that's where I'll be sustainable, right? Otherwise, what usually happens is I've seen a lot of journeys like that. When you create great stuff, a lot of likes, shares happen, people clap, you get awards. But when eventually the sales doesn't come through or doesn't convert into some tangible outcome, it gets defunded. And then you're back to square one, then switch jobs. And that's where I realized that if suppose I want to be in this, I want to still manage a P&L and not like be in a job where I contribute something and just gain creative validation out of it. Because being a lower middle class background family, wealth creation was hard coded into me, basically, that otherwise there's no other go, there's no safety net. You are the one who's going to be like, kind of take a lot of people out of the social strata, one social strata plus the other social strata, right? So yeah. I realized this, I can't be, and you know, these jobs traditionally are very low paying, in India at least. Abroad, they get paid a lot. But then I realized if suppose I want to be in this profession, in this vocation, I want to still handle a P&L. And that's when I will be doing justice and be at peace at least. Yeah.
One small sub question about it. And, you know, this I'm asking out of my personal selfish reasons, which is how do you decide you want to quit a job and then start something of your own? How did you make that decision?
Yeah. See, I think it's fashionable to see that I woke up one day and felt like, I'm going to quit the job and go and do something else and fish in the waters. But it always there's all your decisions in life are the product of circumstances. It's not that you can be brave enough. I mean, we are not brave inherently, right, in taking these calls. So when I was working there, suddenly I realized that this place, maybe where I was working, suddenly variables change, bosses change, this, that happened. And then usually when you are at a place for 5 years, that is the point when you realize that you want to switch, right? So I was at that point of time, I thought I'll switch a job, maybe go to some place else and reap the whatever equity I had built and do something else. Because in my family, I'm the first generation entrepreneur. Nobody in my family ever has taken that path of entrepreneurship or that risk-taking appetite. I never had that. So when I was actually interviewing for jobs, one of my colleagues told me that, dude, you know what? If there is no skip, I mean, the parameters are going to change. Variables are not going to be the same, right? So I realized that this is going to happen everywhere. I mean, I wanted to do creative stuff. I was not much into project management and being the hub and trying to be jack of all trades and not doing anything. Any MBA, what they give you is basically you become a conductor of sorts. You are the hub. Your job is to get things done. And by working through different stakeholders, those stakeholders can be their subject matter experts, but you can't be a subject matter expert. You have to be someone who's managing stuff, who's entrusted with a particular P&L, who's entrusted with a particular top line kind of target. You have to meet that. So you do around with and you work around with all these guys and try to deliver that. So I realized this is not something I wanted to do. And then there was a friend of mine who had started an agency, and I asked him that how's it working out. He said it's fine. It's a lot of trouble. A lot of there is a lot of gadhamari as well. But at least I'm doing what I wanted to do. So then I realized, ek baar try karte hain. And you know, I will be very honest. The point is, one of the major reasons what I wanted to do was because I had an equity built on Gabbar Singh for over the past 10 years, a lot of good network. That was my safety net, actually. This is a safety net I built for myself. That fine, if nothing happens, at least I have the safety net. I can still earn money here. And then this network will feed in somehow to my business. But you know what, when I started up, it wasn't that easy. It's not that people follow you on Twitter and the moment they realize that, you've started a business, they'll give their business to you. That's the toughest thing to sell, right? So I realized I have to do stuff to show that, fine, this is what others are trusting me, so you can also trust. And that's where it has built so far. And it's become like a kind of a network effect has kicked in, and there's a lot of pull now. So
And I think that's having that safety net is just like, just helps you to take that leap of faith, because as you were referring that, we don't have that courage usually, or we don't, we are not very brave usually. So maybe just having an every aspiring entrepreneur or, person who's listening to this and watching this, if, you have that safety net, you might really, just take that leap of faith and be more confident about your idea. So very well articulated that one. Something that you were referring to that, you also had a blog before, and then you were also referring about, some copywriting related books that you keep reading. Do you yourself enjoy, let's say, would you call yourself an advertiser or marketer, or let's say you would call yourself a copywriter? What would you refer to?
I've been a copywriter 10 years of my life on Twitter. That's what I've been doing. I've been writing copies day in, day out. I've been writing, trying to basically abstract thoughts. I'm trying to, because Twitter has a handicap of characters, right? So you have to be concise. You have to, the brevity is the essence, right? So I realized, because there was a 10-year long kind of a training to this job, I guess I would say. And what happened was, I realized Twitter is like a tool where I sharpen my knife, right? And then I go and hit briefs that come to me. It's very much easier for me in a very short amount of time. I can deliver results which are satisfactory for the client. That's like, fine, this can go ahead. And what I also realized that because I don't have any formal advertising experience, I escape such trappings of following a particular routine. So that is, and also what I've done is also in my hiring is where I've consciously taken a call that I won't be hiring many advertising folks. Because the point is, whenever I present to a client, our usual, the deck name is not who we are, it's why we are. That's how we present, because there are 20,000 people. This is not new business. This is not a new business model. We are not breaking any fresh ground. We are just doing some things differently, basically, right? And that's all it is. And what is happening is that when I tell people that, fine, this is what I follow, and this is the way I do business, is basically trying to create my own house, and you're trying to fund me, because first 2 years I'll be trying to build a body of work. And which is going to help me itself, right? And the first 2 years, you are like my venture capitalist. You are funding my ideas to build my own house, right? So, and that's where they also get excited that, fine, this guy has skin in the game, right? It's not just like you create something and sell it off and forget about it. I'm going to be proud of it. I'm going to put it on my website. I'm going to feature it. Show it to other clients as well. So for me, the first 2 years is the phase where I'm trying to build my own house and put my own house in order with using the creative style created for clients. And that's how we have grown the business as well.
While you were mentioning about how you don't hire folks from the advertising space, I think this is somewhere I read maybe in one of your podcasts or in tweets that, you you don't have a sales team or a business development team. Your clients are like your sales team. Can you explain us like what does this mean and what do you refer about this?
See, I'll tell you how we grew. The first client I got when I was in my notice period, one founder pinged me and said that, can you help me? Because they would have seen my work and they had this
Just
inkling.
quick interruption over there. So, like when you say that, you know, a client approached you, were they approaching Gabbar or Ginger Monkey was already formed
No,
at
no, no,
that
no.
point?
So Ginger Monkey was not formally announced till last year. I mean, I only announced it 26th of May 2020.
Oh, got
In the
it.
middle of the
Okay.
pandemic, though I started the business in 2019 itself and I quit my job in July. So the 1 year period I had was the period when I was building stuff, trying to build clients. And how, so one guy being Gabbar Singh said, can you help me as a consultant maybe? Then it struck me that why should I be giving my ideas for someone else to execute? That's the easier part, right? Why can't I put together a team and start doing it? So I hired one guy, and that too not as a full-time employee, someone who's helping me, and we started this. And I was the first employee. And then what happened was, we started working, good work started coming out. Though people, nobody knew about this, I was not disclosing that this is Ginger Monkey, I'm associated with it. I used to share stuff on my Twitter as well. And then that guy quit his job, the marketing guy quit his job and went somewhere else. And then again, he gave us a job. Then yeah, we had two clients then. Then suddenly this guy told someone else that we are doing a great job, you should approach them. My employers came back and told me that, fine, why don't you do it for us again? And that's how we grew. And three people to six people to 18 people to 20 people like that. So that's how we have grown. And then it's all been word of mouth. And I'll tell you without taking names, now we have briefs from the world's top three advertisers. So in the sense
Oh.
that, and it's all been word of mouth. Some of them would have seen it on Gabbar. And the best part is now all the inquiries I get, almost 80% of them haven't heard of Gabbar.
Oh, that's a good thing. That
Yeah.
means the brand has been built and has
Yeah.
been established and word
Yeah.
of
Someone
mouth.
would say that we heard about you from someone in Google, someone in McKinsey. And now we have also suddenly a lot of founder groups, right? A lot of LM groups like McKinsey, BCG, and these guys. In that those groups also names starts has started floating. So someone is a founder is like, yeah, we did a good job with them. Why don't you approach them? And that's how it's been. I think, you know, in this current age, word of mouth is pretty easy because people are so connected, right? I mean, the cost of communication is so low that if you are doing something good, it's like how a meme spreads, right? Similarly, a B2B business can also spread the same way. I don't think so. Just as a great product doesn't need a marketing a team, maybe like a WhatsApp, a great B2B, I mean, kind of a product or kind of a service can also spread, can also go viral as such by word of mouth. And that's what we have seen. So we have consciously not approached anyone. I don't remember any of my team members or me ever pinging anyone coldly on LinkedIn that, okay, we are doing this great job, why don't you approach us? Never I have, even existing clients as well, I don't even go and tell them that, why, okay, do you have any more briefs for us? Is there something happening? Can you give us, it was, it we are just sitting right now. Though it could be termed as not aggressive, not as ambitious, but yeah, fine. Yeah, I'm at least having my peace of mind. And in this vocation, right? You need a lot of white space as well. You can't be just running every time. And in those white space, only you can create something which is of value. Otherwise, you'll be churning out run-of-the-mill stuff. So that's
Yeah.
how we roll. Yeah.
And I think a lot of entrepreneurs, you know, just grind themselves and, you know, just burn out with, you
Yeah.
know, being very ambitious or over ambitious is what I could say. I'm going to come back to more questions about advertising, some campaigns that you have done and some other things, but I want to go back to 10 years, where you said, and I think you started three accounts, Basanti, Kalia, and Gabbar, right? Tell us how, why did you think of starting those three accounts, and then how did you stuck with Gabbar forever?
So it's a question I'm often asked that how did it start actually? See, it started with an accident. Of course, I was in Bangalore that time, I guess. Bangalore or Korea, I don't remember. Maybe Bangalore, I guess. Yeah. So I was at my home and suddenly I had a blog which was like, yeah, theek hai, 150, 170 readers per blog post. I mean, in those days it was, I thought it was big. So And I was happy with the 20 comments I used to get on my blog, and like, yeah, I'm doing a job is there. I never thought that this could be something that could be a revenue earning thing. I was like, okay, it gives me pleasure. It's like a hobby. And those days I used to say that your dessert can't be your main course. I mean, it's something, dessert is a dessert, right? So yeah. I was always a staunch believer in this fact ki, this follow your dreams is all bullshit. Do your job. Start a family and all, your dependents and everything. Keep doing that and have some pleasure on the outside with these things you do on the internet. And that time when I had a blog, I thought I'll write a blog post with Sholay characters on Twitter. And why Sholay characters? Because following someone on Twitter was something new that time. People had likes, people had fans. You had Orkut, we had friends. So nobody thought you could follow someone. And in Sholay, what happened was that Basanti was followed by the Dakus. So I thought, why can't I say that Basanti has made a Twitter account and these 5-6 Dakus are following Basanti? So that's why I created Basanti, Kalia, some other Dakus, and then Gabbar Singh as well. And I thought, what I'll do is I'll just have some interaction between them and create a blog post, take screenshots, go to my blog, post it, and forget about these Twitter accounts. By the way, I already had a Twitter account by my own name. And I was like, ah, take a thought about followers. Hey, I used to tweet some stuff. I had some friends on Twitter, general, regular stuff. And then what happened was I went back and when I came in to delete those Twitter accounts, like, how get take a blog post, ho gaya mera. And when I saw them that, so Basanti Kali I deleted. Then when I came to Gabbar Singh, I saw 20 retweets. And 20 retweets in those days, inflation adjusted will be 1,000 retweets now. So I thought, kya, ye toh acha chal raha hai, ye badhiya hai, toh fir I got sucked in. I tweeted more stuff. And the very next day, my flatmates came running to me and said, dude, he was also an early adopter on Twitter and stuff. Dude, you should follow this Gabbar Singh guy, very funny. So I said, no. there's something which is, I thought, no, okay. So this is, I haven't told him, suddenly somehow it has reached him. So it must be something good. And those days, Twitter was very, very dry. You used to have journalists and people talking about all tech-related stuff. It was like something new that time, a parody account and stuff. And yeah, so I started tweeting and it's been 10 years now. Got a lot of media mentions. Outlook featured on the cover page in April 2012, I guess, and all the newspapers covered. So I had that moment of like my 15, 20 minutes of fame then. And then it normalized and I kept on doing. And at one point of time in 2015, I monetized as well when I started getting brand endorsements and stuff. So I was like, if you get brand endorsements and if you start earning money, then only it sustains. Otherwise, it will die out. In any hobby you have, I often tell this to a lot of people, if you have a hobby, it will die out if you don't monetize it.
Yeah.
If you're a painter in your school life, in your college life, you would paint something. But if you are not able to sell it or monetize it, although it's a way of, I mean, a hard way of looking at things, because people think hobbies are softer. And why do I need to monetize it? Why do I need some scrutiny over it, right? I mean, whenever you try to sell it, people will scrutinize it and might critique you as well. So people are not ready for that criticism. So, but when you do monetize it, you'll keep doing it more often and it won't die. That's where it sustained. Else I would have gotten busy. I got married in 16. So I would have left it maybe. I would have said, theek hai yaar, ab family chalo gayi hai, let's focus on job, this, that. But then because it was monetizing, it paid for my loans and stuff. So I was like, theek hai yaar, karte hai isko. And then in 2020, I thought, ki chalo yaar, business ko lete hai.
So like, tell me from, let's say, those 20 retweets when you had the realization, oh, this is going good, this is going nice, and that 10-15 minutes of fame also. Now it's like a 1.3 million audience, right? How do you manage that right now when you're tweeting something, let's say, out of, like, initially it was like, okay, whatever comes to your head and then you tweet about it, but now when you tweet something, what is the mindset, and you know, how do you manage an audience listening to you?
Yeah, the only thing is I still don't think about it, that there are 1.3 million people reading it. I still feel that there are 20, 30 people who are reading it and I can tweet whatever. The only filter I do these days is because now I'm responsible for a group of people, young people who are employed with me. So I can't be that rash as well, talking whatever comes to my mind and try to ruffle feathers, because what can happen is, I mean, they might, I mean, these guys who have put their trust in me might get robbed of that. So I don't be as evasive as I was earlier, but I still tweet whatever comes to my mind.
So like, I mean, imagine like today, it's Saturday night. Like you think about, you know, you maybe you are eating something or drinking something and you just feel that, you know, let me tweet about it.
Yeah.
Like you tweet about it.
I have AMAs, dude. If you go through some of my AMAs on Twitter, what I do is I just ask people, okay, ask me anything. And people ask random questions, man. And what I do is I read the question and whatever comes to mind, I reply. And I guess that spontaneity maybe has a value, maybe, that has seen it through. Else, had I been like all politically correct and tried to make all the right noises, people would have moved on. And I'll tell you a fact, how this content ecosystem works, at least for the content creation system works, is you have a shelf life. Any comedian, any content creator who's there will have a shelf life. Say Zakir Khan, Mallika Dua, and all these guys, right? All of them have shelf lives because there's a particular mannerism you relate to for a few years. And then that mannerism becomes stale and new people come in and replace you, right? That's how it is basically. Smarter people are those who basically what they do is while they are at the top, they make enough money to last them forever. But in India, it's not possible because there's not too much money like in the US, right? So what they do is when they are at the top, they try to recruit the next set of people. So that instead of them replacing you, why don't you get them under your fold? That's what AIB did, All India Bakchod, right? They did it well. But I don't know, in a moment of madness, they gave it away. Otherwise, that's what TVF has been doing. TVF writers initially were really good, right? And they were creating content and stuff. But what they did was they built a content powerhouse, a kind of an umbrella, which could take in newer, talented people. And when they came in, they started creating value. So once you have that kind of an umbrella, it's very important to be an umbrella than be a kind of a one-man army, right?
Yeah.
So, that's where a lot of businessmen, that's where a lot of these content creators have done well when they have created that institution. How they have gone. They've been relevant.
Yeah, makes sense. And not like, let's say, every creator can, you know, expand their skills to all dimensions.
Yeah.
Like every creator, he or she will have certain limitations. Like somebody can be like a great copywriter, but then if you feel that, you know, YouTube is booming and video is booming, podcast is booming, but you don't really are like a conversation kind of person and still get into podcasting, then it's not going to really work out for you.
Yeah, true.
So it makes sense to, you know, just recruit or partner or collaborate with other creators and, you know, just go ahead about it.
Yeah.
You were mentioning about, you know, spontaneous AMA sessions that you do. Mm-hmm. Tell us the weirdest question that you have got and the weirdest answer or reply you have given to someone.
There have been so many, actually. I'll have to, I should have been prepared for this question. But then, I mean, there have been quite a few, man. People will suddenly ask, why aren't you having a kid?
Out of nowhere, like just something.
Out of nowhere.
Is it like one of your relatives or chacha, mama?
People are crazy, man. See, the thing is, though, what Twitter gives is that soft anonymity. You can be someone and tweet something and run away. There's a lot of hit and run happens on Twitter. So people will come and randomly ask something that, what's your salary like? How much do you earn? And it's crazy, man. The kind of question that come up, I'll share some links with you. You can go through them. It's been crazy. And you know, the funniest part is that a lot of people are now telling me that they look forward to those AMAs because they find it funny. They find it some people find motivation in it. Some people find, I mean, see, I guess a lot of people like us, all of us want to create something, want to like maybe do a business, but then we have all our limitations. Yeah. A lot of people don't have that safety net that to venture forward. So that's a thought that's in their mind, but they realize, nah, yaar, there are too many limitations, the risk taking, there are too many dependents I have. I can't take this risk. And then, you know, the whole issue of the startups ecosystem, feeds on this survivorship bias. Only the survivors get to talk about it. And there are like plenty of failures around. You have so many horror stories that people who were good at their job, quit their job, started something, it didn't work out, and now are looking for a job. And they came back and basically wasted 2-3 years and sat in the same position that they left. So there are a lot of horror stories, there are a lot of those stuff that is happening, which you take solace in that. Fine, I'm doing my job, I'm not like starting up, I might be doing something right. Even I was of that opinion. If you look at my Twitter from 2010 to 2019, I was the guy that don't follow your dreams or bakwas. Do your job. There are a lot of dependents on you, and feed them. Don't take that risk. And so I had this thing that if you are good at something, do it for the payslip. If you're really good at something, do it for the invoice.
I think that's the most creative take on, you know, passion project, side project, hobbies, and, you know, pursue your dream kind of thing. I'm going to tweet this after this recording.
My philosophy that, okay, fine. This is time to work for the invoice, maybe. And it has worked out so far.
So that's super. But before I move on to some more technical questions, I want to ask you, what did you reply to that person who asked you, why are you not having a kid? Or like,
so I told him that we are due in 5 months. It's actually true. So I'm going to become a father soon. I mean, in a month's time now.
Wow, super. I congratulations, and I hope it's all great. I'm going to ask you something about, you know, tell us about some of the work and campaigns that you have done with Durex, AirAsia, Urban Company. Yeah. And more importantly, how, you know, this sets apart Ginger Monkey as a unique creative solutions organization.
Exactly. So I'll tell you a lot of work which we did at Durex earlier, which basically defined and some, I guess, moment marketing was it's in fancy then, and there weren't many brands doing it. I guess Zomato was one, and Durex, I guess Swiggy was also like starting to do it. And that is when we did a lot of immediately, like the rupee went to 69 rupees a dollar. We did something on 69 for Durex. Prince William, I guess, or Harry, I guess, I don't know, I'm confused between the two. When they were having a kid, and when Virat and Anushka were getting married, so we did a creative saying that let no one come between you except us. So that got us a lot of controversy for Durex, but it did really well. And we used to do those moment marketing things. But one campaign I would share with you, which thought which can say that fine, we are doing things differently. Schindler, if you know the brand which makes elevators, right? They came to us saying the very kind of a one-line brief. They said that issue with Schindler is that they have two competitors in India, Kone and Otis. And both of them are like four-letter words, very easy to pronounce. And we are a Jewish-German brand, and Swiss brand actually, which is a different, difficult name to pronounce in India at least. In not just India, Southeast Asia as well. In Europe, people are aware that you can pronounce Schindler, but in India, they are Skindler. Then they are not able to pronounce it. They are not able to write it as well. So what is happening is they're losing a lot of recall because of it. I mean, it's easy to say that if someone asks you which lift brand I should go for, I go for Kone and Otis. But you know, Schindler is also a great brand, but you won't say it because you don't know how to pronounce it. And Indians, of course, are English is not a native term, and we think that we have to be right at it to get acceptance in those social circles. So the brief was pretty simple. How to make Schindler pronunciation popular? How can we teach people how to pronounce Schindler? And then we realized that we worked on a very simple concept that Indians, at least, right, always look for learning the right pronunciations of word the easier way, the softer way, not the harder way. What is the harder way of learning pronunciations is when you are in public and you pronounce something wrong and someone corrects it for you, right? Then you go back at that and asleep at night and think, damn, I should have learned that, right? This is something which is very shameful. People associate a lot of shame with mispronouncing words. Even though you have done great in your life, you've gotten all those degrees from IITs and IIMs, but in a public setting, if you pronounce something wrong, immediately your social currency goes down, at least in your eyes, at least. You feel like, arey yaar, ye to galat kyun bol diya maine, shit. And people will laugh at it as well. And I've seen people who have learned the pronunciation just the day before, the very next day they start judging people who pronounce it wrong. That's what happened.
Yeah.
So I realize that this is what is happening, and we need to give people the softer way to learn pronunciation. So what I did was, we created an Instagram filter, which basically was like usually they had the word spinning and everything. So basically what we did was we picked up 10 most mispronounced words in India, and we created this filter which it could flip, and it would first challenge you to pronounce it right, and then you'll give the right pronunciation. And often people would figure out, oh damn, this is wrong, I should learn about it. And we also wanted to keep a score, and in the end we'll also plug in Schindler as well. So then in every kind of a session, they would learn how to pronounce Schindler, not just them, but their followers as well. And this was one, this was an Instagram wala audience. Then another TG we wanted to hit was a LinkedIn TG. So we got Ankur Wari Kuwar and Ranveer Alabadia to do this, where they would have pamphlets and they will flip it. And they would challenge their audiences as well to pronounce it right. And it was like, how do you pronounce P-O-E-M? I mean, we have learned to pronounce it poem, but it's not poem, it's called poem. Right. So and that was a hit with kids. A lot of parents started showing that video to their kids, and it became we got like at least 10,000 comments on that LinkedIn, at least 5-6 times, all organic, by the way. And so many people came to us and this is very nice, my kids are loving it, and this is a great way to learn pronunciations. And in all those sessions, people learned how to pronounce Schindler. Right. And it was and what happened was, post when we did it, it went to Switzerland as well. The head office saw it, and they then told us that we want to roll it out in 35 countries. And the managing director of Schindler Global loved the concept. He said, this is great. I mean, at least in the nations we don't know how to pronounce it, we can do it. And so we are doing a toolkit for them, which will go to across all the nations. They are showing it in the UAE Expo as well. This is going to happen in October. So, I mean, a simple idea, a simple thought process done well. Suddenly, we were small then. We hadn't disclosed our name then. And it suddenly became big, and it went to Switzerland and stuff. So that's small. We believe in working on human insights work the best. If your campaign thought has human insight driven into it, it will do. It will go the farthest, basically. Yeah, that's been our modus operandi been like.
Got it. In the past, I've spoken to a lot of advertising folks, founders of different agencies and everything else. How do you set Ginger Monkey aside compared to any of the other traditional agencies or advertising organizations that are there in the country?
See, I mean, we are not into this game of saying that we are better or we are different, because see, what we feel like we have built a creative place, and if you share a brief with us, and we'll put our honest effort and show it to you. If you feel like this is something good, it's going to help your brand, come and work with us. We actively don't participate in multi-agency pitches. We say that, fine, if you want to work with us, directly sign a contract and start working. Because we realize there's a lot of time wasted that happens. And we also realize the traditional way that agencies work is basically their top guys will present the stuff to the client, win the account, and then give the execution to the newcomers, basically. And that's when a lot of dissonance happens, when they realize ki yaar ye to bataya tha kuch aur tha aur execute kuch aur ho raha hai. So someone in advertising told me that the day you win an account, you start losing it every successive day. So yeah. I realized that this is good in the sense, because there's not complete honesty in when people pitch for accounts. Then I realized that we are not good at this. We are not good at really sweeping the clients off their feet. We are good at consistent good work, which whatever we promise people, we deliver it day in, day out. And if you work with us for 2-3 months, you'll realize that we are getting a lot of value. And one of the reasons is why we have this thing that we believe in the 0-0 thing. 0% attrition in clients and 0% attrition in employees. This is the metric I usually put tell a lot of people, because all the clients have basically renewed their contract, because they realize that over a period of time, what we've done is we have consistently done work which is satisfactory, which they like. And that's where a lot of nobody has actually discontinued work, and which puts us in a good position as well, because I have visibility in terms of retainers, in terms of more hiring and stuff. So yeah, it's a fun bunch right now. I know difficulties happen when you you scale and things deteriorate, and then that's been the model of any service company. With scale, it somehow degrades and stuff. And so we want to go do good work. I want to hire great people who have a great hunger to do good work, and scale it up. And to give a fact nugget, we have grown 8x since the first year, in the second year now. So
wow.
in the growth perspective, it's, I mean, whatever non-ambitious, non-aggressive approach is also getting us good growth. So why basically fight for it? That's been our philosophy.
No, makes sense. And I think, again, like, superb work that you have grown like 8x in the first year and in the, like, towards the second year itself. I have two last questions for you. Both of them are pretty, like, separate categories of questions altogether.
Yeah.
One is something related to virality and how some brands, campaigns, or some folk go viral.
Yeah.
Do you think virality can be engineered, and can there be like a step-by-step process to making something go viral?
The short answer is no. It's very difficult to engineer stuff. There are a lot of people who would have done two things right, and they claim that they'll get the third thing right as well, but it usually doesn't happen. And I think it all boils down to the basics of doing creating advertising and content, right? You think that whatever you have done is adding value, it's something new, or it is exciting enough for you to share on your personal profile. So this is one of the rules I follow in my company as well, that all my employees, basically, I ask them, the whatever work that you've created or what we have created, is it good enough for you to post on your personal profile, to share, right? Is it that good or not? If it is not, then I don't think so, this is working out. So we strive to get to that quality where we are proud of our work. And some of them, what is happening is suppose there's a digital campaign that we are doing, suddenly the client will say that, fine, oh, this is good, we want to put it on billboards. So we want to make a print ad out of it. We want to put it on Times Avenue front page. And that has happened, and that is happening as well. So then we realize that now, I guess people see us more than just an agency. They want to also, we are a creative kind of a resource. Suddenly one client, one unicorn, basically told us that, okay, you've done good creative stuff. Why don't you help us with the user experience journey? I said, it's a challenge. Why not? And then I started working on that, and my team designed the entire user experience, and we presented to their investors, them and everyone, and the CEO, and we got it approved. So then we realized, creativity is not just about putting up marketing collateral. It's also about, it can be in any part of any product. Basically, you can come in and say that, fine, why don't you do this? Maybe we can start a product maybe in later. So who knows? I'm keeping my options open. Suddenly in one AMA, someone asked me that, what next? This is a service business. Of course, there'll be handicap of scale. Why don't you do a product maybe? So I said, I'm open to it. When I have built enough corpus, I'll maybe start a product maybe. And suddenly I got a mail from a major, multinational FMCG general manager. He said, I saw your tweet and that you want to start a product. I'm willing to fund it. I'm going to come on board. I have plenty of a wealth of experience as well. I want to come on board as an advisor as well. And I want to fund your idea. I said, dude, it was a drunk AMA. So I said, yeah, I truly appreciate your trust and everything, but we'll do it. And that's where we've also said no to any kinds of funding. We have zero debt, we have zero equity dilution. I said, we don't need funds right now. We have a 3-year runway right now. So in that sense, we felt like, yeah, kyun karna hai? Why should I appoint my own boss? And especially in creative fields, right, it's difficult. I understand in product where you have a lot of metrics to chase, and you need someone who guides you as well, right, to get those metrics. But in this business, which is a tried and tested business, what value would a VC bring in? I think, right? I know how to scale. I know I can scale at my own pace. I don't have someone at my, that I can say no to briefs as well. We have said no to a lot of people, a lot of clients who have come in that, no, we don't feel like it doing it. So I don't want that kind of pressure that find karna hai, so that will kill it. That will kill this vibe.
Yeah. I think something that you mentioned before this was, you know, like a metric for you to realize if it's like worth or not, was when the employees, if they will share it on their personal profile
even
or
me,
not.
Even me as well, not just me. Yeah. Can I share it on Gabbar Singh?
That's also, and I think that's a very unique metric to measure if the work that you're doing is, you know, like great or not, or worthy sharing it or not. I think that's a very unique metric. Coming to my last question, and you know, because you have been in this space, not just let's say through Ginger Monkey since last 2 years or more than that, but you have been, let's say, working in the advertising space or marketing space and all of that entirely. And also as a copywriter when you started Gabbar and, you know, while blogging also. How have you seen in the last decade or since when you started, how the advertising space and marketing space has evolved and what it is currently and where do you think it's going to go in the next few years?
Okay. So what has happened is some things have stayed the same because usually who have changed the game are the new age startups, right? They are more willing to experiment. They are more willing to try out new things and get fresh blood in. A lot of bigger startup, what they do is they have in-house teams now because the agency business is so distrusted right now that, as I told you earlier, right, some bright guys will come and present to you. They'll sweep you off your floor, off your feet. And then in the end, the execution happens with smaller guys, I mean, who are younger guys and who don't deliver the same quality. And these guys get dissatisfied and they realize that, fine, why don't you hire 2-3 people, great copywriters who come in? And all these agency guys want to be in client side anyway, right? So they'll hire them and create an in-house team. And you have examples like Swiggy, Dunzo, and all these guys who started their own creative unit in-house. And it has worked for them as well. So there's a lot of distrust that is there. But the traditional FMCG advertising that has happened, right? With the bigger spenders like HUL and Reckitt's of the world and P&G's of the world. What they've done is they've still relied on those bigger agencies, the network agencies, right? And because usually what happens is when you are a middle manager, right, you enjoy that camaraderie, but you enjoy someone at the creative agency who's catering to all your whims and fancies, and you can call them up and they'll come, they'll present some ideas to you. Do you enjoy that? I mean, that's the joy of being a brand manager, and that's where it has stayed the same. It has the whole philosophy of why fix it when it's not broken, and they follow a very set template or the P&G model, which was like Insight, Benefit, and RTB, Reason to Believe, and that is basically any ad you see, any FMCG ad you see, you'll find the same kind of modus operandi. They'll have great product shots, they'll have Das Misse No Dentist Dwara Pramanit, and that hasn't changed, by the way, and that is still selling a lot of stuff. And when I was in FMCG, they used to be saying that creativity doesn't sell. And that's true as well. Sometimes when you try to be true, and because why doesn't it sell is because when you allow a lot of creativity in, what they do is all these ad guys, right, are they wanna be filmmakers, all these guys. They want to make films, but somehow because of life's complications, they have compromised of being an ad director, right? So what has happened is that they'll try to create a film, they'll try to create emotions, but they have to plug in a product as well in the end. So when you give them a lot of leeway, they want to kick out the product. And when you kick out the product, it won't sell. That's the thing. Yeah. And that's where they followed that traditional agency wala mindset. To sum it up, basically, a lot of it is the same. I mean, a lot bigger FMCG is the kind of people who are there, been 20 years, so CMOs, CEOs, hote hain, wo wahi hain, to unke liye wahi chal raha hai jo chal raha hai. The new age startups are doing something different. And that's where we also get a lot of business when people allow us to do a lot of things. But now those guys also realizing that kuch kuch kar rahe hain, hume bhi karna chahiye. They're trying to tinker with it. But again, it is this product of ki yaar, agar sales hogi, to theek hai, otherwise defunded.
Yeah. Anything. Abhishek, I think throughout the conversation, I had some small moments of, oh, yeah. I mean, you know, you have this realization that subconsciously this thought is there somewhere placed here. But when you hear it from someone is when it just strengthens. And you know, I think you said this in the beginning about passion projects and hobbies, that you know, your desert cannot be your main course. And I think it has like just stayed with me throughout the conversation. And while we are, you know, towards the end of this conversation, I'm just thinking it's still stuck with me. And I think something else also that you said was how every creator has a shelf life. And when you, you know, realize that you should recruit newer people, newer creators, people with other talent. And some brilliant points that you have shared throughout this conversation, and I'm just going to revisit and keep, you know, coming back to this episode once it's out there. Thank you so much for giving us your time and, you know, just being here and talking out all of these pointers and insights that you have shared today with us.
Thanks man, it was a pleasure talking to you.
And I'm gonna tweet some of these things, or maybe are the Kalia and Basanti accounts still there or no?
No, they have been deleted. I told you, right? I deleted them. I only kept Gabbar Singh.
And now when people create, let's say, other Gabbar related accounts with the same DP or something like that, like, does it help them or like it just like...
No, see, ultimately, it's not about the Twitter algorithm remembers me, right? So when I tweet it out, it will show it to all those people. Distribution happens that way, right? I mean,
yeah.
When I tweet it out, it'll go to 10,000, 20,000, million people, right? And when they tweet it out, it won't go to them. So
yeah.
They won't be even seeing them. So that's
yeah.
the thing.
Yeah,
fine. They'll appear in replies and all, but I don't bother much about them. Yeah, theek hai, chal raha hai.
Great. Theek hai. Thank you so much again, once again, Abhishek. I think this has been a super, super conversation for us.
Thanks, Pawan. Thanks. I hope it's of some value to people.
We hope you enjoyed this conversation with Abhishek. If you want to check out more such interesting episodes, go to our YouTube channel or the Spotify account, and you might find all past episodes of Pepper Spotlight podcast show. Just to remind you all once again, this was initially a fortnightly show, but now we are releasing an episode of Pepper Spotlight every Wednesday. Make sure you tune into YouTube or Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, JioSaavn, Gaana, wherever you listen to your podcast shows. You will find the Pepper Spotlight show on those apps. If you have any suggestions about whom we should have on these episodes or any questions that you want us to ask to specific guests, please just feel free to DM us on Twitter or on Instagram @pepper_content. And we are more than happy to listen to your suggestions and recommendations. That's all for the 5th episode of Pepper Spotlight podcast. My name is Pawan Rochwani, and I will see you guys next Wednesday again. To give you all a hint about who the next guest on the show is going to be, this person, I think we're bringing a lot of folks, 30 under 30 people. So, and this person is an IIT alumni, has built one of the most interesting, or let's say the most creative organization in the country. Stay updated about who this next guest on the Pepper Spotlight podcast is. Thank you so much, and stay safe, take care.